395 together, 395. I have a song that Jesus gave me. In my heart there rings a melody. Let's all stand together as we sing 395 on that first. I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. There never was a sweeter melody. 'Tis a melody of love. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody of love. I love the Christ who died on Calvary, for he washed my sins away. He put within my heart a melody, and I know it's there to stay. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody of love. 'Twill be my endless theme in glory. With the angels I will sing. 'Twill be a song with glorious harmony when the chorus of heaven ring. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody of love.
All right, good singing, and good to see you in church today. It's good to be home, and had a good vacation and a good time away, good time with our family, and but it's always good to come home. And missed being in church here, and but appreciate the good services you had. And boy, Brother Yoder, Brother Moreland did a great job. Amen. Really enjoyed that. And last Sunday with Brother Mann, and I hope you enjoyed the messages. I did. And looking forward to what the Lord has in store for us today. We are recruiting men for the choir. We're a little slim back there. We got a couple guys out of town, and some other guys who I don't know where they are. But if you want to sing, come join the choir, will you? And amen? All right, four of us can do that. And you either volunteer or we can draft you. One or the other. Let's just, we may institute the draft here, except Brother Moreland, he's excluded from singing in the choir. Amen. Yeah. Don't hang your head. The light reflection blinds me. And he thinks I should still be on vacation right now, you know? Amen. Well, it's good to be in church. And looking forward to what the Lord has for us today. Let's bow for prayer, shall we? Father, we thank you for another Lord's Day you've given to us. And Lord, it's good to be with the people of God in this place. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness to us and for giving us safety as we traveled. And we pray for those who are still gone from us today. You'll watch over them and bring them back to us safely as well. Now, Father, we bow before you and ask you to minister to us today, and that the songs we sing and the would be a blessing to you and come up as a praise to you, that, Lord, we would sing with grace in our hearts unto the Lord. Bless our fellowship together. And then, Lord, speak to us through your word this morning as only you can. Give us all ears to hear what you would want to say to each of us this morning. And I pray and ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
There's a land that I have been told, where the streets are paved with pure gold, and the bright flowers bloom through all eternity. And the dark glistening on the bright shore, to this world can never afford. I've got a reservation, my name's been written down. I've got a reservation to walk on the streets of gold. Yes, I've got a reservation where the pearly gates unfold. I have my name been written down.
town. I'm longing to hear that trumpet sound. I've got a reservation, my name's been written down. There is a banquet table that's spread, filled with milk and honey and bread. We shall dine while the eternal ages roll. Friends and loved ones will be there, robed in garments bright and fair. I've got a reservation, my name's been written down. I've got a reservation to walk on the streets of gold. Oh, yes, I've got a reservation where the pearly gates unfold. In heaven, my name's been written down. I long to hear that trumpet sound. I've got a reservation, my name's been written down. I've got a reservation to walk on the streets of gold. Oh, yes, I've got a reservation where the pearly gates unfold. In heaven, my name's been written down. I long to hear that trumpet sound. I've got a reservation, my name's been written down.
All right. Would you turn with me in your hymnal to 311, 311? Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed. On that verse together.
Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed for his infinite mercy. His child and forever I am. I'm redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, his child and forever I am. Redeemed and so happy in Jesus. No language my rapture can tell. I know that the light of his presence with me doth continually dwell. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, his child and forever I am.
On that last, I know I shall see in his beauty the King in whose law I delight, who lovingly guarded my footsteps and given me songs in the night. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, his child and forever I am.
Now, a few announcements for us. Listen carefully, if you will. 5:30 is our Christian growth class, and we'll be talking tonight on the will of God. The will of God. You know, God has a will for every individual life. God has a will for Christians, but he has a will for individual lives. And you need to, now that you're saved and you receive Christ as your Savior, now you live the rest of your time not to what your will is, but to what God's will is. And you need to find out what God's will is. And so we'll talk about the will of God tonight. That'll be during the 5:30 class. Then tonight at 6:30, right back in here for the evening service. Brother Morton, are you going to be here tonight? Why don't you, do you have any of your slides ready to go from your trip? You don't? Okay. Could you get them ready this afternoon? Could you do it this afternoon and have ready for tonight? You can't? What is it? Your computer's down. Ah, it's at the doctor's. Dr. Dean. Okay. All right. We'll wait till that gets up and running. And then as soon as that is, let me know. And we'll let everybody know you're going to show those pictures. I'd like to see those. All right. Okay. And then remember, fellas, this coming Saturday is our men's barbecue. I want you to come out and be there's a sign-up sheet for that. It's at Windsor Park right down here in Grove City. And come on out and join that. Now, listen, you just bring something to drink and a side dish, okay? We're going to take care of the meat, and we're going to take care of the dessert, okay? We're going to have brownies and watermelon, and we'll have hot dogs and hamburgers, and we'll take care of that. You just bring in, and it'll be no cost. Just bring your drink and bring your side dish, and that doesn't mean bring your wife, okay? I know that's what you're thinking. Some of these ladies are thinking, yeah, I'm going. But no, that's not happening, all right? You're going to bring a bag of chips. No, I'm kidding. But no, you probably can bring some chips, but you can bring a side dish, and we'll put all that together, and we'll have a great time of fellowship, and we'll have a good time together Saturday, 5 o'clock down at Windsor Park. Okay, sign up for that downstairs, fellas, and same as the men's breakfast, you can bring your boys and such. That's okay, and we invite you to do that. We'll have a good time together this coming Saturday. Then remember, August 15, 16, 17, that's Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, we'll be putting together John and Romans in the fellowship hall each evening. And we'll be doing that in preparation for passing them out during the missions conference, during the parade on Saturday. And we get to put them together and then pass them out. It's kind of cool. And so we'll be doing that on those three nights, okay? We'll let you know as we get closer to the time, as far as exact times on those evenings, okay? I think we can get it all done on Monday and Tuesday. He said, is there a sign-up sheet for that, by the way? There isn't. There should be. Okay, we'll make sure there's a sign-up sheet down there for you to sign up that you're going to come participate at. Right now, how many think you'll come and help on that Monday and Tuesday and put together scriptures, okay? Just get a kind of a hand raise. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, good. I think there's at least 30 there that raised their hand. And children can come. Everybody will have something to do. If he said if he had 20 done, we could get like 10,000 done in two nights. So he thinks if we have 30 or so, we'll be able to do that. And he's bringing some extra stuff along that if we get all ours done, we can do some extra New Testaments for somewhere else, okay, or John and Romans. So that'll be great. There'll be plenty to do, and I'll take care of that later. All right. All righty. Looking at this, I think that's all I'll take care of right now. Be thinking and be praying. By next Sunday, I hope, we'll have some of the cards out for the missions conference. That's coming up quickly. It'll be September, when's that start? 15, September 15th, so it'll be coming up soon. Those of you who signed up to help for the missions conference, if you haven't signed up yet, you can down on the table. If you want to have any part in that time of helping out, preparing meals, hosting a missionary, presenting them the gifts and evening gifts and such when they're here, any, just want to help in any way, decorating, getting flags up, anything like that, just let me know. Sign up that sheet down there, and then we'll contact you. We'll probably have a meeting next Sunday for preparation for that time. And so if you have not signed up yet, get your name on that list today, okay, and be part of the missions conference come September. All right. Now, let's take just a moment, and we'll welcome our guests that are with us in the service today. We're always glad when folks visit with us. And if you're visiting today and not a member here at Bible Baptist, I'd love to meet you, find out who you are and where you're from. So if you're visiting today or you brought a guest with you, would you honor us by standing for a moment? We'll find out who you are and where you're from. Susan has someone with her. Who do you have, Susan?
My mom, Betty.
Great. Betty from?
Georgia.
All right. Good. Good to have you, Betty. Thanks for coming to church today. Good. Glad you're here. All right. And Tara? Mrs. Johnson is here. Tara's mom. She was here last week, and I wasn't here last week. So that's the first time I got to meet her, and good to have you here this morning. Thank you for being here. You might have got a card last week. Did you get a card last week? Yeah, I did. Okay. They're good. Thank you, Pete. All right. Anybody else this morning? Okay, very good. Let's give these folks a warm welcome, shall we?
My God.
146, 246. I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. 246, higher ground. Let's sing that first together. I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's tableland. A higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Children, won't you be dismissed for junior church? Children, you're dismissed for junior church. Let's sing that last stanza together. I want to scale the utmost height and catch a gleam of glory bright. But still I'll pray till heaven I've found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's tableland. A higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Amen. Great singing this morning. Let's go over to 228. 228, a wonderful Savior is Jesus, my Lord, a wonderful Savior to me. Let's all stand together as we sing, He Hideth My Soul. A wonderful Savior is Jesus, my Lord, a wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing those last stanzas together. Thank you. with numberless blessings. Each moment he crowns, and filled with his fullness divine, I sing in my rapture, oh glory to God, for such a Redeemer as mine. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand. All together on that last. When clothed in his brightness, transported I rise to meet clouds of the sky. His perfect salvation, his wonderful love, I'll shout with a million on high. He hideth my soul in the cleft.
Be seated if you will. Ushers will come to receive our offering this morning. Of course, it's our higher ground offering, and I trust you've prayed and prepared to give this morning towards the new carpeting for the auditorium here and new lighting and for here and the fellowship hall. And hopefully we get those projects undergoing very, very quickly. Ideally, I'd like to have it all done by missions conference. I'm not sure that's going to happen, but that's what may be our goal for us. But we want to give towards that project this morning, all right? Let's pray, and we'll ask God to bless our offering this morning. Brother Polley, I want you to lead us, please.
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us to where we can come here and worship you, and we pray that you'd be with the pastor as he brings the word and message, and that we'll be able to use it in our daily lives, and we pray that you bless the offering. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Take your Bible this morning, if you would, for our scripture reading. 1 Timothy chapter 6, please. 1 Timothy chapter 6. Three verses we'll read together. 1 Timothy chapter 6. We'll start together on verse 17. I'll read 18, then let's end together reading verse 19. 1 Timothy 6, verses 17, 18, and 19. And as we usually do, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word. Let's begin on verse 17, 1 Timothy chapter 6. Ready?
Charge them that are rich in this world, that they be not high-minded, nor trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God, who giveth us richly all things to enjoy, that they do good, that they be rich in good works, ready to distribute, willing to communicate, laying up in store for themselves a good foundation against the time to come, that they may lay hold on eternal life. And let's pray together. Father, add your blessing, please, to the reading of the scripture here this morning. Father, thank you for the good music today, and we've enjoyed the singing the songs of God. And Lord, thank you for the good spirit that's in this place today. Lord, it's been good to be in the house of the Lord. And I pray that you'll bless the special and that you'll prepare us for the message from your word this morning. Minister to each of our hearts today and use the word of God as only you can. May each of us be yielded to you so that you can say and you can do what you'd want to in each one of our hearts and lives. And I pray and ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
When I think of how he came so far from glory, came and dwelt among the lowly, such as I, to suffer shame and such disgrace, on Mount Calvary take my place. It's then I ask myself this question, who am I? Who am I that a king would bleed and die for? Who am I that he would pray, not my will, thine for? The answer I may never know, why he ever loved me so, that to an old rugged cross he'd go, for who am I? When I'm reminded of his words, I'll leave thee never. Trust in me, I'll give you life forever. I wonder what I could have done to deserve God's only Son, to fight my battles till they're won. Who am I? Who am I that a king would bleed and die for? Who am I that he would pray, not my will, thine for? The answer I may never know, why he ever loved me so, that to an old rugged cross he'd go, for who am I? The answer I may never know, why he ever loved me so, that to an old rugged cross he'd go, for who am I?
Now, Heavenly Father, we bow before you in prayer as we come to the preaching of your word. Father, we thank you for your great love for us and giving your only begotten Son to die on the cross for our sins. Lord, certainly we are all people unworthy. Lord, we're thankful that you so loved us that you'd give your only begotten Son. Now, Father, I pray that you'll help us to see clearly the truth from the passage of Scripture we'll look at this morning. I pray, Lord, that we'll listen today to the message, not just to be hearers of the word, but to be doers of the word. And I pray you'd help us to give our full attention to what you would want to say to us this morning. It seems so easy for us to be distracted, to let our minds go in other directions. I pray you'd help us today to focus and to listen carefully to what you would want to say to each one of us through the Word of God this morning. May the Word of God be quick and powerful and sharper than a two-edged sword. May it divide asunder between the soul and the spirit and the joints and the marrow. May it be a discerner of the thoughts and intents of our heart. So honor again the preaching of your word as only you can. And I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. In the 1 Timothy chapter 6, it gives a great challenge here when it comes to the matter of finances. The number one cause of divorce is finances. Most, if not all, couples struggle with finances. I like what one fellow said. He said, I have enough money to last me the rest of my life, unless I buy something. You know, that's kind of how it works. The wife had been working on the finances most of the evening and poring over the figures, and finally she came into her husband, who was sitting in the family room watching television. She said, well, I worked out the budget. Now all you have to work out is a raise. And that's usually how it works. And so he decided he'd take a shot at it, and the next night he worked over all the figures and was working on things, and he came up to her and he said, well, I've worked it out, but I need a little help. He said, I figured what we'll need for food, clothing, and shelter. We have a choice of any of the two. That's kind of how it works sometimes. But listen, in this verses that we read in Timothy this morning, there's some great teaching here about finances. Some great teaching here about riches. And before you stop and think, well, he's not talking about me. I know rich is relative. And I know you don't have any rich relatives. But I mean, riches is a relative thing to someone like a Donald Trump. You and I would not be considered to have much riches. Okay? But you understand, to 95% of the rest of our world, we're very rich. We're very wealthy. How many of you have a jar or some container at home that you throw loose change into and collect it? Look at that. Okay? Do you know? Put your hands up again. How many of you do that? You're in the top 2% of the wealthiest people in the world. Just want to make sure everybody saw who you were. You know? Huh? Isn't that amazing? Now, we don't look at ourselves that way, but you understand that is indeed rich in the perspective of the world. And we understand that when God, that nothing we have is our own. Everything that we have has been given to us by God. And everything we have belongs to God. Good news for you. It's not your house, and it's not your car, and it's not your clothes. It all belongs to God. And therefore, we have to understand we're managing. That's why the Bible calls us stewards. We're stewards. We're managers of what God has given to us. And all of it belongs to Him. When we lose, by the way, if we don't get that down, then we get to thinking that it's mine. And we're stingy. We don't want to take my money or my car or my house or look what they did to my, or what about my. Oh, no, it's His. It's His. It's not mine. And so here's some, he's addressed already earlier in the chapter the dangers of the loving money. Notice verse number 10, the love of money is the root of all evil. It doesn't say money is the root of all evil. Okay? The love of money is the root of all evil. And some covet it after, they err from the faith and pierce themselves through with many sorrows. So he's dealing with those who love money. He's dealt with already earlier those that will be rich. Your goal in life is not to be rich. Nobody said amen to that. Because that's the American dream or the American goal. But that's not a Christian's goal. No, that they that will be rich. Well, when I was younger, he approached me and he was all big on A.L. Williams. You know, that was going to change your life. Anybody remember that name? A few older folks might remember that name. And it was all about financial independence. Your goal, and I'm in my 20s, and your goal ought to be financially independent. That's ought to be your goal in life. And then when I went to this verse, and I said, listen, this verse says, they that will be rich. In other words, they eat, drink, and sleep. I'm going to be rich. I'm going to make money. I'm going to have lots of money. And I want more money. And I'm going to get some money. And I want to get riches. And I want to have wealth. God says, these are the ones will fall into temptation and a snare, and the many foolish and hurtful lusts, which drown men in destruction, and that's ruin, by the way, and perdition, which is the entire loss, or ruin of your soul. And with that, he called me a young whippersnapper, not wet behind the ears, still wet behind the ears, and he left the church. But I'm not here on this earth to be rich. That's not the goal in life. And so he's warning Timothy here, and Timothy is in turn warning to us about our riches. Now, we've established the fact that to 95% of the world, we are rich. You go to 95% of the other places in the world and look at about how we live in America, we're rich. And so when he says, charge them that are rich in this world, guess what? He's talking to us. Don't pass this passage off as, let them have it, Timothy. Let those rich people, let them stick it to them. One of the favorite things in this political season is always about, you know, the rich got to pay more. The rich ought to pay. And everybody likes to go after the rich. Here, it's coming after us. We are the rich. Who's rich? We are. Who's rich?
We are.
Who's rich?
We are.
We are. Okay? So this is talking to us. Now he gives us four duties of the rich. Four duties that we're responsible for here when it comes to our finances. He says, charge them that are rich in this world that they be not high-minded. So he says the very first responsibility we have is to be humble. We have to be humble. He's charging us, and the charge there is to lay upon him with words. When you charge something, you're coming at him. And he said you have to continually remind yourself to be humble. Rich people can get a feeling of superiority. Those of you who've traveled in other countries, what's the number one complaint they have about Americans? What is it, Ron? Superiority. You think you're better than anybody else. You know what? Riches do that. Riches do that. The pastor, I heard you say, the pastor went over to help there, you know, was amazed that you wanted just to, what do you want us to do? Why? Because most Americans go over and say, here's how you ought to do it. This is the way we do it in America. You see, because we get that superior attitude. And it's easy to happen when you have the materialism and the things that are so constantly thrown up at us as Americans. And it's easy to get our values misplaced. I read a while back that about some hoodlums who broke into a department store in Los Angeles, but they didn't steal anything. All they did was switch price tags around in the store. And so when they came in, customers were fine. They found fur coats for $5. Cold cream for $150, a silver service set for $1.75, but a pair of ladies' hose was $390. Diamond rings were $2, but umbrellas were $1,000. You think, oh, that's funny, and that's kind of humorous. It'd be a nightmare to try to straighten out, but but you know what? That happens in our lives. And we place the wrong value on things, and we think this is more important than what it ought to be. and we switch the price tags. And so we need a constant reminder not to get caught up in materialism, not to get caught up in the things of the world. You know, we think sometimes that the early church was just composed of slaves and poor people. But that's not true. Or this wouldn't need to even be written. But there had to be some wealthy people. There had to be some rich people that were part of the church. And so Paul tells Timothy, through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit here, that they're those that are rich in this world, see, in contrast to the world to come. They're rich now in this world with this goods that, because listen, a person can be rich now but end up being very poor later. You have to understand. Remember the rich man Lazarus? The rich man died and he was in hell. But the beggar died, who was just a beggar, never had anything in his life, and he died, and guess what? He was ushered into the bosom of Abraham. And he had it, he had everything he wanted then. He was poor now, but he's rich then. And there are those who are rich now, but they'll be poor later. And so the constant reminder is that we not get caught up in the materialism of this world. And boy, that is, listen, that's not easy to do when you live in the United States of America. It's easy for people who are rich to develop a superior attitude. It's easy for people who get wealthy to develop an idea that this is God's favor. That's the health and wealth gospel that's preached and being preached across our country this morning. And men standing up with corporate jets and diamond rings and different homes in different parts of the country telling you that that's all God's favor. And that if you were right with God, and the truth is, if you just sow a seed into my ministry today, God will bless you with those things. Wealth can make somebody proud. God declares, back in Deuteronomy, he said, don't you, in fact, look there with me, would you? Put your finger in 1 Timothy and go back to Deuteronomy chapter 8, would you please? Deuteronomy chapter 8. Notice what the Lord told Israel. God is saying here in Deuteronomy 8, notice with me verse 16. Deuteronomy 8, verse 16. God said, who fed thee in the wilderness with manna, which thy fathers knew not, that he might humble thee, that he might prove thee, to do thee good at thy latter end? And thou say in thine heart, my power and the might of mine hand hath gotten me this wealth. But thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, for it is he that giveth thee power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant, which he sware unto thy fathers as it is this day. Yeah, children of Israel, they were coming through the wilderness time and they were thinking how they took care of themselves. And God is basically saying, are you kidding me? Who fed you with the manna? Who gave you the water from the rock? He said, listen, I took care of you and it's in my power for you to get wealth. So listen, it's not a matter of the job you have. It's not a matter of who your employer is. It's not a matter of what you are. Listen, it's God who can give you the wealth. It's God who's given us these things that we have. And so we give God the glory. And we're to honor God with our substance. Possession of wealth ought to humble a person, not make him proud. It ought to humble us to want to glorify God with what he's given to us and bring praise and honor to his name. If you use your wealth as a measurement of pride, you're using the wrong measurement. It's like the little boy come running to his mother and he said, Mom, I'm 9 feet tall. She said, what? She goes, I'm 9 feet tall. Well, how did you arrive at that? He said, I measured myself. Well, how did you measure yourself? He says, I took my shoe off. It's a foot and I'm nine shoes, my foot, and that shoe goes on my foot, so I'm 9 foot tall. She goes, listen, son, you're using the wrong measurement. You have to use a ruler. It's 12 inches. A lot of people measure themselves by the wrong measurement.
and they get a false assessment of who they are. You can't measure. That's why God says you can't measure yourself with somebody else. You can't compare yourselves among each other or measure yourselves by somebody else. You're not wise. That's a false measurement. And you get to thinking you're better than somebody, or you get to thinking you're not as good as somebody else. And in either way, it's destructive. So you keep the standard the way it ought to be and use the standard that God gives us. In fact, Paul tells the church at Corinth, he says, what do you have that you have not received? In other words, what do you have that God hasn't given to you? Years ago, I remember preaching in Tucson, Arizona, and there was a man who came up and he said, God did all this stuff. He said, these hands earned what I have. These hands earned the house I live in. These hands are what worked and got the clothes that I wear. So I worked hard for what I have for the last 35 years. And I'm glad you worked hard. But let me ask you a question. Who made it possible for you to get out of bed in the morning to go to work? Who could have kept you on your back, unable to move, if he wanted to? So the fact you had the strength, and the fact you had the health, and the fact you had the ability to even go out and work, comes back to God. God gave you that ability to do that. And so you honor God, and it's a humbling thing. What do you have that you have not received? Don't be proud of something in which there really is no glory. The little boy was so proud he was 9 feet tall, but that was a false assumption. Don't get proud of something that should not be pride at all. I said in Sunday school, there's no place for pride in the life of a Christian. It's always such an oxymoron. In other words, something that doesn't go together when somebody says, I'm proud to be a Christian. What? Pride in the Bible is never mentioned in a good light, not one time. Never. Pride was the first sin of Satan that cast him out of heaven. He was pride. Hey, the pride, hey, the sin of Sodom wasn't sodomy. It was pride. Sodomy was a sin. But that's not why God overthrew them. It was pride and fullness of bread, refusal to help others. You read about in Ezekiel. Pride. Pride and pride. God says, so the first responsibility we have is to be humble. Be humble. Know who gave us what we have. God has given us what we have. And the goodness of God should lead us to repentance. It should humble us. Remember when Peter was fishing and the Lord said, cast you down the other side of the boat, and Peter didn't want to, so he let down a net. And then it was so full of fishes the net even break. What did Peter do? He fell down at the feet of Jesus and said, depart from me, I'm a sinful man. What did that big multitude of fishes, more than he ever caught in his life, what did that do to Peter? It humbled him. He said, Lord, I don't deserve this. Can you really look at what you have, church? Can we really go home and look at our home and look at our vehicles and look at the clothes we wear, look at the things that surround us and say, I deserve all this? Or do you look around and say, God, I'm humbled by what you've done for me. I don't deserve this. It ought to be humbling to us that we have such things. So it's God who gives us the ability to get wealth. There's no basis for pride. So the second thing he tells us, number one is to be what? Humble. Number one is to be what? Humble. Number two, he says, they be not high-minded, nor trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God. The second thing is, trust in God, not in gold. Trust in God, not in gold. You don't set your hope on the uncertainty of riches. You remember the fellow who said, oh, I've got my barns full, and I've still got more, and I don't know what to do. What should I do? Tear these down and build bigger ones. And what did God call that man? Thou fool. Why? This night your soul will be required of thee. And then whose this going to go to? You leave it all behind. Doesn't matter. Hey, he who gets the most toys doesn't win. Okay? That's not what life's about. Life's not about gathering possessions. That's not what your life consists of, Jesus said. You don't. In fact, Solomon, who had wealth, who had riches, he said that money or wealth makes itself wings and it flies away. Gone. Just that quick. One day a fairy came to a man and told him that she would grant him any favor he would wish. He thought for a few minutes and then he said, "I'd like to see a newspaper published 1 year from today." Immediately the fairy handed him a newspaper printed 1 year in advance. Immediately he tore it open, went to the stock pages and went down through the stocks and he said, "I'm rich! I'm rich! I got $15 million!" And then he went a few more pages back to the obituaries and his face fell because he said, "I died 2 days ago. I died 2 days ago." There's no U-Haul. There's no U-Haul following the hearse. It doesn't go with you. Riches are uncertain. Riches are very uncertain. Remember the crash of 2008? They keep saying another crash is coming. All the riches and all the wealth is going to be destroyed. That's why Jesus said, "Don't lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where thieves will break through and steal, or corruption will come, or moths will corrupt." He says, "Lay up for yourself treasure in heaven." That's secure. That never takes a hit. Never loses any value. You have to trust in God, not in gold. Riches can be lost. They can be stolen. They can be destroyed by fire. They can be devastated by a bank failure, or a business failure, or a market crash, or eaten up by inflation. You can't afford to trust anything but God. God's the sure one. He's a secure one. You say, "Well, I'm just on Social Security." No, you're not. You're on God's security. God's the one that takes care of you. Let God take care of you. Trust in God, not in gold. Be humble. Trust in God, not in gold. Number three. Then he tells them this. He says, enjoy what God gives you. Notice he says, not trust in uncertain riches, but in living God who giveth us richly all things to, what? Enjoy. So he provides things for our enjoyment. In fact, in Psalms, he says, all the gold and all the silver is mine. So God is rich, and guess what? He shares that with us. Just for our enjoyment. That's okay. He gives us, my God, when the church at Philippi gave to Paul and gave to his missionary endeavor, Paul gave them a promise. He said, "My God shall supply all your need according to His riches in Christ Jesus." Not even from His riches, but according to His riches. And so God gives us what we need. And He shares it liberally and He shares it abundantly. Everybody here in this room, we have more than what we need. We have more than what we need. We do. And so we understand, let's enjoy what He's given to us. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 9. Would you turn there, please? 2 Corinthians chapter 9. Are you all right? Okay. 2 Corinthians chapter 9. Paul explaining to the church here in Corinth about giving. Chapters 8 and 9 are great chapters on giving by grace. And grace, by the way, grace always does more than the law. Whenever you come Jesus on the scene, he said, you've heard it said by them of old time. And whenever Jesus said whatever it was, then the next thing that Jesus said, "But I say unto you," was it a lower standard or was it a higher standard? It was always a higher standard. Always higher by grace. And so when people say, "Well, I don't believe in tithing, that's under the law, I believe in grace." Well, then you believe in giving more than 10%. Usually that's not the case. Usually they want to use that as a reason why they can give less than 10%. But grace gives more than that. Grace lovingly gives more than that. Now he tells the church here, notice in chapter 9 of 2 Corinthians, He said in verse number 6, but this I say, he that soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly. He which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Every man according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give. Not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. All right? That's what we're supposed to do. What's God going to do? Verse 8. God is able. If that's all we said right there, that'd be enough. God's able. But he says, God's able to make all grace abound toward you, that ye always, having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. He gives us all sufficiency in all things that we can abound to every good work. What more do you want? What more can we ask for? How can we not enjoy what God's given to us? And God says, I'm able to do that for you. But you have to do your part. We have to do the first part. Legend has it, a certain country in search of a king sent two ambassadors to choose between two infant twins. They found the two little fellows asleep. But they noted that one lay sleeping with his hands clenched in a fist. And the other lay with his hands wide open. And that's the one they chose to be the king. And his generosity, he became known as the king with the open hand. You know, we have a God with an open hand. Hey, Romans 8 says, he that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him freely give us all things? If God gave us his son, what else could, everything else is below that. He would gladly share that, and he does. And what God gives us, he wants us to enjoy. I've come that you might have life, and you might have it more abundantly. There's nothing wrong with enjoying what God has given to you. Nothing wrong with that. God gives it for our enjoyment. And delight yourself in the Lord, and he'll give you the desires of your heart. Don't think that I'm not allowed, I'm a Christian, I'm not supposed to enjoy anything. I'm a Christian, I'm not supposed to laugh or have a good time. Some people behave that way. That isn't what the Bible teaches. Doesn't mean you have to take communion with lemon juice. You know, you're allowed to enjoy life and enjoy living. That's okay. That's what he just said. He giveth us all things richly to enjoy. The church had a ladies' sewing circle. They had a contest to see who could look the saddest, the meanest, and the ugliest. And a lady won who wasn't even playing. that's bad. Sometimes, especially young people, they kind of think, well, God's just up there figuring out what he can do that I can't have any fun, so that I can't enjoy anything. And that's not true. But God is trying to get you to know, listen, that the blessing of the Lord, it maketh rich and he adds no sorrow to it. That the blessing that God wants to give you will never have an accompanying sorrow coming after it. Everything the devil will give to you will always have an accompanying sorrow that comes along with it. Oh, it's pleasure for a season. It's fun for a season. But oh, that sorrow comes and it's no fun at all. And God doesn't have that. When you enjoy what God's given to you and you honor him and you give glory to him and you enjoy him, listen, then that's pure enjoyment. And there's no sorrow that comes. Enjoy what God's given to you. Nothing wrong with that. Be humble. Trust God, not gold. Enjoy what God's given to you. And then let me give you number 4, lastly. Employ what God's given to you. Enjoy what God's given to you, but employ what God's given to you. What's that mean? Well, verse 18. That they do good, that they be rich in good works, ready to distribute, willing to communicate. He says, I want you to do good, that you be rich in good works. Someone said that 80% of all the money used for ministry, for evangelism, for missions, comes from the American middle class. It is never surprising when you look at the people running for public office. And make no mistake, most of them, not all of them, but most of them are in the millionaire class. Even though they talk about being for the middle, the little guy, the middle class guy, they're not middle class people. And oftentimes when they release tax returns, you see that their income was $1 or $2 million. And you'll see that they gave maybe 1% to charity. Maybe 2% to charity. It's very rare indeed that you see somebody tithe or give more than that to charity. And so he's charging them here, be rich in good works. God counts on the middle class. Here's how it would work. It's been said if we reduce the world to one village of 100 people, take all the population of the world, put it down to just 100 people, here's how it would shake out. 70 of the 100 would not be able to read. One would have a college education. One out of 100. 50 out of the 100 would suffer from malnutrition. 80 would live in housing that's unfit for human habitation. 6 people would control half of the money of the entire village. That's Americans. That's what we control. Why do you think we're falling behind? And we have fallen so far behind in the Great Commission? I'll tell you why. Because Americans become self-centered. And we're spending money we should be giving to get the gospel out on ourselves. I just spent a week up in Wildwood, New Jersey, and watching everybody vacation. They have a boardwalk there with all the, carnival games and places to eat, and people just throwing money. Unbelievable. And I get back, and there's a letter on my desk. I haven't given it to Brother Moreland yet. Somebody hand him a hanky, but you'd get a letter from a church saying financial difficulty. We've tried to cut back other areas. We're going to have to start cutting back on our missionaries. What's happened to our priorities? You see, that's what's happened. We are not being rich in good works. We are not giving like we ought to give. We're taking it all in for ourselves. We're willing to cut back? Are we willing to live a more simplistic lifestyle that we may have to give to the cause of Christ and give to world evangelism? Over half the world, 3.5 billion people, have not yet heard of Jesus Christ. Not heard the gospel. Not one time. The wealth we possess, it's not just something for us to enjoy. It's a responsibility that we have to embrace and realize what our responsibility is. So he says here, be rich in good works. And notice he says, ready to distribute, ready to share, ready to give. I read a shocking report a while back. It said this: if every church member in America lost their job and went on welfare or unemployment and then gave a tithe of their government check, the giving in the United States churches would rise by 30%. Shame on us. I read about one minister who said he went to visit his parents. And he noticed when he sat in church with his dad that day, his dad put a $20 bill in the offering plate. And at lunch that day, he asked his dad, "Is that what you put in every week?" He said, "I put $20 in every week ever since you were a kid. That's what I do every single week." And he said, "I got to sit down and lovingly show my dad, but Dad, your income has tripled from the time you did that when I was a kid." And he said, to his dad's credit, his eyes were open, and he said, "I'm going to correct that." And to his credit, he corrected it and began to give as God would prosper him, and as God would be equivalent to his income. Made the changes. Look at Ephesians chapter 4, would you? Ephesians 4. And while you're turning over there, don't talk out loud. But why do you work? Why do you work? Why do you have a job? Now, you have a job without a doubt to provide for your family. If any man provide not for his own, he's worse than an infidel that denied the faith. You have to provide for your own. And God gives you the ability to labor. But notice what he says here. In verse number 28 of Ephesians 4. Let him that stole steal no more. But rather let him what? Labor. Working with his hands the thing which is good. Remember that they do good. Right? So I'm going to work with my hands the thing which is good, that I may have a nice 401k to retire on. Oh, I'm sorry, doesn't say that. That I may make good investments so I can retire. No. Nothing wrong with those things, by the way. But that isn't what it says. What did it say? That he may have to give to him that needeth it. Remember the early church? You read about in Acts chapter 4? Neither was any among them that lacked. How come? Because they brought stuff in. If they had two coats, they brought one of them and said, "I don't need two, I got one. Here, give this to somebody who needs one." And they gave it laid at the apostles' feet, and they distributed to the people in the church who had needs. That's how they cared for each other. That's how they took care for one another's needs. When people were in church and people were all part of a church family, you know what the church did? The church took care of its own. That's why you didn't have welfare in the United States. It wasn't the government's job. But when people left the church, they left the people that would care for them. They left the people that would help them through tough times. And so then what? They cried to the government to do it. And so the government ended up doing it. And the churches didn't take care of it. Because the churches, listen, if they don't want anything to do with the church at all, why would they want the church to help them out? But we're to work and we're to labor, so we have to give to them that need it. Hey, who needs it more than those who need the gospel? Who needs it more than those who've never heard of Jesus Christ? Let me tell you this, and I don't want to cast light on this church that wrote the letter, but you know what? The way to get God's blessing on your finances is not to cut missionaries. The way to get God's blessing on your finances is not to cut back your giving to God. See? You don't okay, God, I'm gonna take what's yours so you can help me out and bless me. That's not how it works. Give, and it shall be given unto you. Good measure pressed down, shaken together, running over, shall men give into your bosom. And we like the good measure pressed down, shaken together, running over. We like that part. But the very first word of the verse is, we got to give it. If you don't do that part, you don't get the second part. Rich in good works, generous. And then back in 1 Timothy, what God says happens when we do that. Notice what he said in 1 Timothy 6 again. When we're rich in good works, ready to distribute, willing to communicate, we lay up in store for themselves a good foundation against the time to come. We're laying up treasure in heaven, just what Jesus said. Let me read something to you. Charles E. Fuller had the old time gospel hour on radio back in the 50s. He announced that he'd be speaking the following Sunday on heaven. And during that week, a letter was received from an old man who was very ill. This was part of his letter. He said, "Dr. Fuller, next Sunday you're to talk about heaven. I'm interested in that land because I've held a clear title to a bit of property there for over 55 years. I did not buy it. It was given to me without money and without price.
But the donor purchased it for me, a tremendous sacrifice. I am not holding it for speculation, since the title is not transferable. It is not a vacant lot. For more than half a century, I have been sending materials out of which the greatest architect and builder of the universe has been building a home for me, which will never need to be remodeled or repaired because it will suit me perfectly, individually, and will never grow old. Termites can never undermine its foundations, for they rest on the rock of ages. Fire cannot destroy it. Floods cannot wash it away. No locks or bolts will ever be placed upon its doors. No vicious person can ever enter that land where my dwelling stands. It is now almost completed and ready for me to enter in and abide in peace eternally without fear of ever being rejected. I do hope to hear your sermon on heaven next Sunday from my home here in Los Angeles, but I have no assurance that I shall be able to do so. My ticket to heaven has no date marked for the journey and no return coupon and no permit for baggage. Yes, I'm all ready to go, and I may not be here while you're talking next Sunday, but I shall meet you there someday. Hallelujah. That's the assurance God wants everybody to have. You can have, listen, if you are not certain that you're going to go to heaven one day, you need to settle that. You need to put your faith in Jesus Christ and know that you have eternal life. Because that's what he said, verse 19, that they may lay hold on eternal life. 1 John 5 said, this is life. He that hath the Son hath life. He that hath not the Son of God hath not life. These things are written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that you have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the only begotten Son of God. Eternal life is not something you guess at. It's not something you hope for. It's something you know. And you know it if you have Jesus Christ. He's the one that gives you life. And by the way, that's living. Years ago, there was a Texan who had gotten rich on oil. He bought a lavish white Cadillac and every bell and whistle on it you could think of. And he drove it constantly through the community, advertising his wealth to everybody, bragging about his wealth. Of course, one day he got ill and he was not going to recover. And his request was that when he died, he'd be buried in his Cadillac. And of course, sure enough, they dug a hole big enough cemetery to put the Cadillac in and laid him out in the back seat. Somebody walked by the grave that day, and he looked down in there and saw that guy stretched out on his Cadillac, and he said, man, that's living. No, that's stupid. You see, that's not living. That's not what life's all about. You can listen, we have to be so careful. Charge them that are rich in this world. Listen to me, Christian. Because we sit and we begin to idolize the people who have money. We begin to idolize the people who have fame because they're on a TV program or on a movie screen or they have lots of money. We begin to think, oh, that's the life. Oh, man, they've got it made. Boy, if I had that kind of a... Why are they overdosing? Why are they taking their life? Huh? How come they're not happy? You see, that's not life. The Bible says when you live in pleasure, you're dead while you live. No, it's a dead end. I tell you, some of you in this room, you've seen the way. You've seen that side of things. You've lived on that side of the tracks. That's not living. Loving God is living. Knowing Jesus Christ is living. Taking the gospel to people who've never heard it before in their life, that's living. That's what it's all about. That's what really counts. It's a great responsibility we have. God says, here's what you do if you're rich. And who's rich? It's us. Be humble. Make sure you're trusting God and not the gold. Enjoy what he's given to you, but employ what he's given to you. Give. Give for the furtherance of the gospel.
What can I do to simplify my life? What can I do to cut things down and say, I want, why? Because I want to give. I told the Sunday, was it Sunday school class? I said, we have this building to enjoy now. You know why? Because somebody decided back in 1970, 46 years ago, that they were going to give to build an auditorium. That they're not here to enjoy anymore. You know why we have a Bible-believing, fundamental Baptist church right here? Because they said, let's do something that'll live on after we're gone. Now it's our turn. And if those children who are out in that fellowship hall are going to have a Bible-believing, independent Baptist church to be a part of when they get our age, we better do our part. That's our job. So we can pass it on to another generation. If you've never come to know Christ as your Savior, come to know Him today. Good news is He's here. He said, when we gather together, there He'll be in the midst. And He's right here today. If you don't know for sure you're on your way to heaven, trust Him as your Savior today. If you, hey, those of us who are rich, let's be humble. Let's make sure we're trusting God and not our gold. Let's make sure we can enjoy. Hey, it's okay to enjoy what God's given us. But let's make sure we're employing what He gives to us, putting it to use, that we're ready to communicate, ready to distribute. And we're laying up treasure in heaven, not treasure on earth. Let's pray, shall we? Father, take the truth now this morning. Thank You for the counsel, the advice, the charge from Timothy that we've taken to our heart this morning. And Lord, we've established, we know that because we're in the United States of America and most of us in this room didn't choose that. We were born here. That was Your choosing for us. And so we realize that also carries a great responsibility. We want to fulfill the responsibility. We want to follow these guidelines, this charge that You gave Timothy. We want Your blessing to us to humble us. We want Your blessing to us, Lord, to cause our faith in You to grow, that we'll trust in You and not the gold. We'll trust in the giver and not the gifts. We'll enjoy what You've given to us and know that You want us to enjoy it. But You also want us to employ it. Put it to work. And so, Lord, help us. Help each of us to do as You speak to our heart to do. Lord, I pray that we'll get the gospel to the ends of the earth. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. I'm going to finish praying in just a moment. But I wonder this morning how many folks in the room would say, Pastor, I know that if I died today, that I'd go to heaven. You said, He that hath the Son hath life. He that hath not the Son of God hath not life. Pastor, I have the Son of God. I know that Jesus is my Savior. I know that I have eternal life. Pastor, here's my hand as a testimony. Would you slip it up for a moment that I may see it? All right, you may put it down. Is there somebody here today who would say, Pastor, I don't know for sure that if I died, I'd go to heaven. I don't have that assurance in my heart. Would you let me pray for you? We'll not embarrass you. We'll not call you out, but I'll pray for you. Would you slip your hand up and say, Pastor, pray for me this morning? All right. Wonder how many believers here today would say, Preacher, the Lord spoke to my heart today about this charge of though they that are rich in this world. Pastor, I truly want to be humbled by what God's given to me. I want to make sure my trust is in God, not in my gold. I don't want to get my values mixed up. I want to put the wrong price tag on things. I want to enjoy what God's given to me, but I don't employ what He's given to me too. I want to put it into service for Him. I want to be ready to distribute, willing to communicate. I want to lay up treasure in heaven. Preacher, God spoke to my heart today. Please pray for me. Would you slip your hand up, Christian? Amen. Amen. All right, you may put them down. In a moment, I'll pray and we'll have your invitation. Listen carefully. If you're here today and you've never received Christ as your Savior, as soon as I'm done praying, the pianist will play, Brother Bob will sing. You step out from your seat, come right here to the front. I'll meet you. We'll have someone take a Bible and show you how you can know you're on your way to heaven. You may be here today and you're saved and you've never been baptized after salvation, you ought to come and say, Pastor, I need to be baptized today, and obey the Lord in baptism. If you're saved and you're baptized and you believe this is where you ought to belong and serve the Lord, then you ought to come and say, Pastor, I want to serve the Lord here at Bible Baptist. Christian, you just want to come and pray. Bow the knee to God. Be humbled before Him. Ask Him to use you. Ask Him to help you to be a good steward of what He's given to you to manage. Then the altar is open for you this morning. Heavenly Father, bless this invitation. May Your will be done in each heart and life now. Thank You for decisions that have been made already. And I pray, Lord, that each one would respond to what You're telling them to do in their heart. May Your will be done in these next few moments. And I'll thank You for it. Quietly, with your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, the pianist will play. As she plays, Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart today. You respond to Him this morning, will you?
You have longed for peace and for faith to increase, and have earnestly, fervently prayed. But you cannot have rest or be perfectly blessed until all on the altar is laid. Is your all on the altar of sacrifice laid? Your heart does the Spirit control? You can only be blessed and have peace and sweet rest as you yield Him your body and soul. Would you walk with the Lord in the light of His word and have peace and contentment always? You must do His sweet will to be free from all ill. On the altar your all you must lay. Is your all on the altar of sacrifice laid? Your heart does the Spirit control? You can only be blessed and have peace and sweet rest as you yield Him your body and soul. Oh, we never can know what the Lord will bestow of the blessings for which we have prayed, till our body and soul He doth fully control, and our all on the altar is laid.
Sing that chorus with me, right?
Is our all on the altar of sacrifice laid? Your heart does the Spirit control? You can only be blessed and have peace and sweet rest as you yield Him your body and soul.
Go ahead and be seated for a minute, if you would, please. Name here this morning. Thank you. And we're glad to have Cindy. Is that Lay? Good. I've talked to you. I used to know some Lays. Not potato chips, okay? But L-E-Y. Yeah, I did. All right. And, of course, Cindy is coming here for membership this morning. She's coming from the Valley Forge Baptist Church or Baptist Temple. Yeah, I think it is. Okay, and she's been saved and baptized, of course, and coming by transfer membership from there. She's moved here from there. Now that's in near Philadelphia, but you're originally from Indianapolis, because I kept saying Cindy from Indy. I remember that. And so we're glad to have Cindy coming this morning to join our church. And all those in favor of welcoming Cindy into the fellowship of our church, let it be known by a hearty aye and opposed by like sign. God bless you, Cindy. That's great. When we go to the back, we'll have Mrs. Wallace bring you back too, so you can stand there and folks can greet you on the way out. All right? Welcome. That's great. Praise the Lord. We're glad the Lord sent you our way.
We're excited about what's going to happen. That's wonderful. The evening school of the Bible, the Grove City School of the Bible, many of you were involved with that, about a dozen of you or so last year. The fall classes will start up again August 30th, okay? And there'll be a sign-up sheet this evening of those interested in continuing on with the courses, or starting the courses for the first time. But we need to get that material ordered and get that ready to go. Do you want to have a meeting with those folks tonight, Brother Ron? Is that what you'd like to do, or what would you want to? Would that be a good idea, especially if they're new? They might like to know what that's all about. And tonight you meet with Brother Moreland right after the service, and we'll give you the conference room downstairs, and make sure you meet with him and Brother Yoder about Evening School of the Bible. That'll kick off August 30th, okay? And so it's maybe I'll have Ron say more about that this evening and help you understand what that is. But it's great Bible training. Some just help you to be a better Christian, help you in teaching Sunday school, anything the Lord just better equips you to do whatever God wants you to do, and be ready to go. So it's a great thing. It's on, you do that on Monday and Tuesday? Just Tuesday nights. And from, it depends on how many classes you take. You can be from 7 till 10, I think, isn't it? 10 after 9, okay, if you do all three classes, I think. But you can pick one, two, whatever it is, the different classes that are offered. So if you want more information on that, you want to find out what that's all about, you meet Brother Morton this evening. If you're not going to be here tonight but you're interested, just say something to him this morning, and he'll write your name down and get you the information you need on that. Okay? All right. Let's stand together. We'll have a word of prayer, and then we'll sing our song of dismissal, and we'll look forward to being back in church tonight for the evening service. Father, we thank you for this morning. Now, thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you for speaking to our hearts today. Thank you, Lord, for Cindy coming, for membership this morning, and for your working in her life. And, Lord, I pray that we'll be a blessing to her. I believe that she already has been and will be a blessing to us and to the church here. Pray you help her to find exactly where she would fit and what ministry she should serve in, and that, Lord, you'll give her clear direction on that. And, Father, I pray that you will dismiss us now with your care. Make us mindful that you go with us from this place. Give us a good afternoon and bring us back for the service this evening. It's in Christ's name that we ask it. Amen. 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 I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. Brother Bob.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood, joined hands with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm a part of the family of God. Amen. You are dismissed. We'll see you tonight.